Okay, great. Thank you. So hi, everyone. I'm Jay Lyman. I'm a librarian here with Seattle Public Library. I want to welcome you here to our event tonight. And thank you for being here. I'm going to now turn things over to Michael. And Michael, I'll let you introduce yourself. And let me know if I missed something here, too. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Jay. My name is Michael Coffey, and I will share my screen if I can figure out which mouse to use, because Jay and I both have two computers going at the same time. Okay. Does that look good? You see the slides and maybe me? You don't really need to see me, but I'm just here talking. This is Elements of Strategic Marketing. My business is called Ardea Coaching, and I help small businesses to do all kinds of things, but usually sort of in the online marketing use of technology, as well as sort of, you know, other general brainstorming, problem solving, coaching sorts of things. So a little bit about me. In the past, I have owned a couple of companies. I was, if you've been in Seattle for a long time, you might remember Games and Gizmos, which was a game store. We had one on Capitol Hill, one in Bellevue, and one in Redmond. And I was on the board of that company. I have worked for the U.S. Small Business Administration's program called the Washington Women's Business Center. So we helped primarily women and people of color to get into business, to kind of balance the demographics of the business world. And I've done a lot of other businessy sort of related things. I've taught marketing and project management at Seattle Central College. So that's a little bit about me. Today, we will look specifically at strategy and in part how strategy is not always what everyone thinks that it is, but let us get to this slide. So this is the overview of today. We will start by looking at saying no for fun and profit. And then we have these five colors and shapes. I realized that I wore my bright red shirt last week, and it would have been better for this week because of the colors. But we have five different pieces that need to be put together to have a full, true strategy for marketing. And we'll go through each of those individually, and we'll have breaks to ask questions and so forth. And I want to encourage anyone that's in the class now to either put in the chat, or when I stop and ask for questions, unmute yourself and ask the question. Jay is, you know, he's my designated interrupter. So, you know, like say something in the chat and, you know, we have a good relationship. He'll just be like, stop, you know, stop talking, Michael, and get your question asked.
I'll throw in some jokes here and there too.
Yeah. And we sometimes have jokes. Yeah. The other thing about this particular slide is my little man there. He is a reminder because I try to use a lot of, this one doesn't have it, but I try to use a lot of sort of old time images as a reminder that technology doesn't have to be scary, that technology is just a new way to do something that humans have been doing forever. So the telephone is just a new way to have a conversation. A car is just new-ish way to, you know, go to another place faster, you know, and so computers do lots of other things. So if you ever get stressed, just remember this guy and look for the common historical old-timey thing that the modern tool is trying to do. So that's my reminder for that. So without further ado, let's talk about saying no. And I used to have a different picture here, but I switched to the bonsai because it was more relaxing than the previous one that I had, and illustrated the idea just as well. So if you are going to make a bonsai, you get a tree, little baby tree, and you have a picture in your mind of what you think this tree could become, right? Like, oh, it's got a nice little pot and it's got that rock and it could have the roots hanging down and, you know, the shape of it and so forth. And so over months and years, if you are the caretaker of a bonsai, you keep that end result in mind, that picture of what could be. And as the tree grows, it's going to send out shoots. And you don't know where, because you're not the tree. You can't control that, right? The tree just sends out whatever. And you, as the caretaker, try to shape that. And you may, you know, snip off a branch here and snip off some leaves there and use a little bit of wire to nudge this branch over. And that is really what strategy is. It is looking into the long term and keeping that in mind while you make tiny little to kind of funnel things toward that vision. Now, there are a lot of people who use the word strategy to mean a tactic. So for instance, they might say, Facebook is your marketing strategy. Well, Facebook isn't a strategy, it's a website. You know, or they might say, well, our strategy is word of mouth. Well, word of mouth is what your customers do, not what you do, and there's no end goal in mind there. I mean, implied, maybe, but that's not a strategy. Also, the idea of no is very important in being strategic. I worked with someone once who will remain nameless, but who essentially believed the opposite, who believed that in order to be strategic, you have to say yes to every possible idea that comes up. And you have to try everything and keep all of the possible balls in the air, because you never know. One of them might be successful. But essentially, that's using randomness to try to get to your goal. Saying no to things that you know are less likely to be successful so that you can focus your energies on things that could be more successful is really what strategy is about. Okay? So think making a bonsai, saying no to lots of different things along the way over time to get to a future vision. Think that as strategy. Okay. So here's a class participation section. So these, I took these numbers, the percentages from a client that I worked with. And this describes a pathway from sort of the first encounter that a person might have with a business all the way to the desired goal. Okay, so let's sort of walk through this first. And then I'm going to ask you a question and I'd love to hear what people have to say. Okay, so we start with 10,000 people seeing your website or your some page on your site in their search results. They search on something vaguely related to you and their, you know, Google or Bing or whoever, DuckDuckGo, lists you. Okay, so you have shown up in front of 10,000 people. And only 3% of those people, or 300, actually click on your link. And that's not an unreasonable number. So 300 people click and they go to your page, whatever page came up in search. May not be the best page for them to be on. It may not be the page that you want them to first see, but they go there and at least they're now on your site. Now, of those 300 people, 55%, slightly more than half, click again. They click on something and they go to another page. Okay, so now they're at least on the second page on your website. Okay, so you've got 165 people now kind of exploring your website. And of those people, a little bit more than 10%, 19 people actually add something to the cart, right? Their shopping cart. They have found a product that they are at least willing to say, yeah, this is kind of what I'm looking for. Now, most of those people, about two thirds or 12, go through and actually check out with products. They have purchased something from you. And then of those 12 people, only one person returns to buy a second time. Okay, so this is a real, currently still existing business, and these are real numbers. Okay, so you get 10,000 people to see you on your website, you get one repeat customer. Now your numbers are probably going to be different. But the question here is, if your goal is to get more return customers, where should you focus your attention? Which step would you like to, you know, do you think you should go for? Jay, what would you do?
I'm going for the 165, like 165 people view more than one page. That seems to me.
Why would you, so for what drew your eye to that one?
I like it because it's not, I think I like it because I can like maybe action more 165 then I can think about 300 or 10,000.
Like it's more like handleable
Yeah, influencing 165 people versus influencing or the actions of 300 people.
Sure, sure.
And there's a great comment, focus on the people who complete the transaction.
Yeah, yeah. So that's Courtney. Yep. Courtney said, focus on the 12 people, right? And I can, you know, like we could argue that those 12 people, by having shown a commitment to, like, they have already given you money, right? Like, they're past that hump. They got all the way to the end. So maybe they are more likely to do it again than any of the other people, right? They're further down, so they're more committed. Right? The 10,000 people, they're not committed, right? They haven't even chose to click on you yet. Anyone else? Give me one more. So, which is, you know, that's fine if you don't have an opinion. Really, the right answer can be any of them. The only wrong answer is all of them simultaneously.
I knew this was a trick question.
It was a trick question. Yes, I was seeing if you were paying attention during the bonsai thing. yeah. So, each of these could be focused on. Right, we want more than 10,000 people to see us in search. And that suggests that what you want to do is search engine optimization. Search engine optimization would also help with the 300 people, like enticing more people to click, right? Maybe you change information about your page so that either it shows up higher on the search results or the little blurb that it shows is more appealing to the kind of customer you want to attract. The people who view more than one page, I actually had a client whose page where most of the people arrived had no links to other pages. And so it's like, okay, hold on, hold on. Here's something that we can do easily. We can just add links to that page to try and funnel people out into the rest of the website. Right? So that's sort of how do you get the 165 people get more than 11% onto the, or rather the 300 to get more of them than 165 to start exploring. Getting more people to add something to their cart. You know, maybe it's better product shots or product descriptions. Maybe it's prices changing, you know, like adjusting prices or having a sale or people who bought this also bought or something like that. Completing a transaction, oftentimes, particularly on starting businesses, the process of checking out on a website might be clunky. There might be some kind of barriers or confusions that cause people to not complete the transaction. And so by fixing those problems, you can get more people to slide on through to your cash register. And then, you know, how do you get people to return? You could improve your business. You could give, you know, fun add-ons. Or I worked at a place once where we actually worked specifically on that step. And we put a coupon in. The only discounts we ever gave were coupons in boxes that people purchased online. And so every time someone used a coupon, we knew that that was a repeat customer. And so we could see, well, is this their second order? Then that coupon helped us get that second order. And we played around with stuff like how much time before the coupon expires Is 30 days enough? 60 days, 90 days? Like, where's the sweet spot where people will use the coupon, but not forget about it? So there's different things you can do at every single stage, but imagine how overwhelmed you would be if you tried to do all of that simultaneously. Okay, so any questions at this point? I want to let that idea sink in. And let interpreters switch if they need to do that.
So let us know if you have them in the chat, or if you want to come off mute and ask questions out loud. That's cool too.
All right, then off we go.
Fun and profit.
Fun and profit, yes. Why isn't it not there? Okay, so here we have the first of our shapes. And these shapes are going to be, we'll see in a second how they kind of fit together. But the most important one, as you might guess, is that final result. Like, what are you trying to achieve? Where are you trying to go? And so that's why it's a star. That's why it is bright red. And you want this result to be as specific as you can. I often will sit down with a new client and say, okay, what are you trying to achieve? You know, like, what do you want your marketing to do? And invariably, they will say, well, I want more business. And I'm like, yeah, because your business, that's, you know, like, yeah, everyone would like a little more money. can we narrow it down to something that's, you know, that's like, how would you know that your marketing was successful? Right. And so like, if someone says, well, I want more money, I'll be like, okay, so if you make one penny more this year than you did last year, you're a success. And they're like, no. And I'm like, okay, well, so more money isn't specific enough. How much more money? Selling what? Doing what? From what kinds of customers? And so, so defining and getting really granular with what you're trying to achieve will actually help in the long run. And we'll see that as we go along. But I've put here some bullet points to illustrate the kinds of the diversity of goals that you might have, of results that you might want to see. And these are just categories. So each category could have lots of examples, but I just want to go through the categories. So the first one is exposure or discovery. If you are new, if this is a brand new business, no one has ever heard of you. So probably the first thing you want is for people to have heard of you, right? Like, they can't buy from you and your revenue can't go up if no one's heard of you. So getting some exposure, helping people discover you is probably an area that's going to be useful. And that can happen in lots of ways, right? That's kind of that 10,000 people see you on search level. But it could also be things like, you know, signage in front of your business, or getting written up in, you know, on a website or a blog or a review or something like that, right? Just how do you get your name out there? That's exposure and discovery. The second one is educating and cultivating. So when I first got my my coaching certification, I'm a, a certified professional coach or a life coach, except for professionals. And, you know, like we have lives too. but when I first got that, the idea of coaching, the concept of coaching, the term life coach was not something anyone had heard of. This was, you know, the early summer, 2001. So, you know, 23 years ago, it wasn't a thing that most people had heard of. And if I said, oh yeah, I'm a professional coach, they're like, oh, what team? And I'm like, no, not that. It's coaching. It's kind of like therapy for people that don't need therapy. It's like, I'm a sounding board and I help you be more successful, but you're the one that's in charge. And so my marketing at that stage was this educating and cultivating. It was helping people to understand not just that I existed, but that the concept of what I did existed. It might be that you are doing a thing that is done in a very different way than people first think. I'm thinking of, well, no, that's not a good example. But if imagine you are selling the first electric assist bicycles, right? And you say, I sell bicycles. They're like, oh, cool. I know what you do. And you're like, no. No, these are better than those. That would be an educating or a cultivating. It may be that people take a long time to make a decision, and that also fits in here. If you sell something that is like a really high ticket item, it's or a big commitment or something like that, and it's a long process. This educating and cultivating is kind of part of that also, because you're not kind of going for a quick sale. You're trying to build something before customers are ready to buy. Okay. The third one is spreading. So spreading is like you want people know you exist, people get what you do, but you want to kind of spread the word. Right. So word of mouth kinds of things would be in this category. Typical advertising would be in this category. You've already established kind of the basic ideas, and you're just trying to make that circle bigger. Okay. That's a different set of results that you might be looking for. Converting is lower down on our list. Converting is in online marketing, a conversion is someone doing a thing that you want them to do, take a specific action. That action can be something really concrete, like you know, putting a down payment on something, or entering their information, creating an account, signing up for your newsletter. Or it could be sort of more subtle. It could be, you know, they were willing to be interviewed, or they watched more than 75% of your video. Or, you know, all kinds of things. But if someone does this chosen thing that you are watching, if they do that, they are a conversion. So if you have a specific action that you know is kind of the leverage point, then you could watch that and convert getting more people over that particular hump would be the conversion. Okay. And that can be the result you're going for. Repeating, whether that's a repeat purchase or writing another review on another product or telling even more friends about you. All of those things are repetitions of something that they did before. They converted, if that's something that you had identified before. If they converted before, you want them to do it again. So each of these is kind of obviously a marketing related idea as a result. The last one is less obviously marketing, but is just as important and just as valid a result. And it can be you want to learn something. You want to gather information. You want to understand your customers better. You want to know how they use your product. You want to know what they think of your product. You want to know what path do they typically take through your website? You want to know, right? You may want to know lots of different things. And a lot of people don't think of that as marketing, but all of the tools of marketing can be used to make that happen, to make that gathering of information possible. In fact, there is a book by Ryan Levesque, with an S in the middle of his last name, called Ask. And it's a great little book, very, very thin. And it's all about essentially how do you use surveys or interviews to gather information to create products that your audience wants. And how do you do that as a cycle? How do you gather the information and then use the information to produce more things that people will buy from you? Okay, so there's a whole bunch of categories of possible result. And that, you know, that's our target. That is our North Star. That is our guiding beacon in being a strategic marketer. Okay, so here's how it fits in. This is just a sneak peek ahead. You can see here that the result is smack dab in the middle at the top. It is in pride of place. Pride of place, is that the phrase? So everything else expands from this. The other thing to notice is that they expand in twos. So you've got your star, you've got your result. And then next to that, you have two orange circles. This is because you won't always have just one best answer. But you also want to say no for fun and profit. So you want to limit yourself, right? So you can have two, you can have one, don't have more. I'll shake my finger at you. So you have two orange circles. And then for each circle, you have two yellow-ish pluses. And then for each plus, you have two green boxes. And now there's a reason why we only have one triangle per box. And we'll get to that when we talk about the triangles. But so you've got two, two, two. And those expand outward. Okay, so just keep that in mind as we go through the rest of this. Who? We'll have a break for questions after the next slide. Who is the orange circle is a group of similar people. If you took the class last week and did the homework of, looking up a target market, we're talking about that now. So who is a group of people that are similar in some way? Now, you can group people in zillions of different ways. But what you want to do is narrow it down to two groups, one for each orange circle. And you want those two groups to be the two groups that are most likely to help you achieve that result. So, who are those people? Well, first is your potential audience. Right? Actually, brainstorm. We need a little graphic. Brainstorm time. what is the difference between audience and customer? Ideas, please. Oh, come on.
And feel free to type them if you like to.
Yep.
Type them in. I'll say them out loud.
Your voice does not need to be heard. All right. Well, I will just give you
Michael,
the answer.
Michael, I'm sorry. Can you repeat the question? It was cutting off for me. Thank you.
What is the difference between audience and customer?
Okay.
Yes.
Customer is someone who take money out of their pocket and to put it in your pocket.
Yeah. Yeah. A customer takes money out of their pocket and puts it in your pocket. An audience doesn't necessarily. They might. But an audience, I'm teaching some high school students Latin right now. And Audi is the command, listen. So your audience are the people who are listening to you. Are they acting on what you say? They don't have to. But as long as they're listening to you, they're part of your audience. And a customer hands you money. That's a very different thing. which one is better? I don't know. You could argue that. So your potential audience are people who might find what you have to say interesting. Your current audience are the people that are already listening to you. Your current customers are the people who have already purchased from you, right? Notice these can be distinct groups. But it doesn't have to be people that might buy directly from you or who are buying directly from you. It can be industry people, right? Who are your colleagues? Maybe your colleagues are the right people. Maybe it's a referral partner, someone that is not a competitor, someone who's not even in the same industry, but someone who has contact with the kind of people that you might want to work with. So over my years as a professional coach, I have made a number of referral partners, and the most lucrative, I guess, the most fruitful for me have been personal trainers and various health providers, chiropractors. Personal trainer, I guess, kind of fits into that same category, but because those are people who regularly have contact with those who are willing to pay money for someone to help them reach their goals, right? And that's what I provide. So, you know, so even though a personal trainer and a business marketing coach, you know, very different work, but similar care, you know, our customers have similar characteristics. And so that's useful. And maybe there are other groups, right? You know what your goals are. What makes a good who circle is going to depend on what your result, your desired result is. Okay. Now, if you have done the business model canvas, as a way of organizing your thoughts about a business, this kind of corresponds with the customer segments chunk. Not necessarily. It could be key partners. It could be some other things. But you know, like if you're used to that format or that structure of the business model canvas, customer segments, you know, could be something you could just plug in right here. Okay. And then related to that, we have the where, the yellow-ish plus. And so for each of your whites or each of your orange circles, each of your who, you want to ask the question where. And you get two of these. So group A, right? Circle A, whichever one you want to choose. Where are the two best places that you can have a high concentration of that kind of person? Now, notice that I said high concentration because just the fact that there are a lot of them in a particular place doesn't make it a good place. And that's one of the ways that people use Facebook wrong, maybe a little strong, but you know, a lot of business owners are like, well, there's a bunch of whoever I'm looking for, lawn maintenance people. There's a lot of dog walkers, there's a lot of cat owners, whatever, on Facebook. And yeah, that's true. But what is the concentration of those people? And to illustrate this, I had a client once who wanted to market to Microsoft project managers. And their initial idea was to buy TV ads during the, you know, primetime shows. And I was like, why is that your choice? Like, what's good about buying ads? And they said, well, because no doubt most of the project managers at Microsoft watch TV. And I said, yes, I agree with that, but probably most of the project managers at Microsoft watch TV. And I said, but how many people that are looking at your ad are not Microsoft project managers? Like, how much money will you be spending to market to the people that you don't want to work with? And that's when they were like, oh, I want to find where that group is the largest proportion of the audience, not how wide can I spread the seeds. and that's sort of the central question here of where. and you're looking for the two best places, right? You have the two best groups of people, but then you want to find the two best places to find those groups. So it might be on a social media site. But don't just choose the social media site that you are most familiar with, because that's rarely the right choice. Later classes will have more on social media, but there are all kinds of factors that go into choosing a good social media site for marketing. And it is almost never the biggest one. For example, one of my students at Seattle Central in a marketing class, they had to write a marketing plan. That was the whole quarter was essentially, you know, pick a business, pretend that's your business, write a marketing plan for it. And we did all of the little pieces and so forth. And when we did social media, this one student who had chosen, well, I'm a private charter jet, like high-end private jet charter company. I was like, okay, great. What are you going to do for social media? And he did a ton of research and came up with a social media site I had never heard of before, but it was a social media site specifically for travel reviews for rich travelers. So it was the kind of people that go to like the top restaurants, the top hotels, the, you know, best of everything, you know, money is no object kind of travelers. And he was like, well, I'm going to advertise here. And I'm like, well, that's genius, because like every single person on that site is going to be your customer. Right? If you went to Facebook, that would not be the case. So, it doesn't have to be social media. It can be blogs. Do they typically, you know, does your audience or your group, whoever you're looking for, typically read the same kind of blog or publication, or go to the same websites? Maybe they subscribe to email newsletters. Maybe they do things in real life, whatever that is. I understand that happens in a place called outside, but you know, I live in a black void. So who knows? But you know, like maybe they go places. Maybe you're looking for dog owners and you go to the dog park, right? Like, what better place to find dog owners than in a dog park? And there might be other places, but where are those places where your people are a much higher percentage than in other places? And pick your two best for A and your two best for, yes, I've heard of this place called Outside. It's supposed to be bright and shiny sometimes. I don't know. But I've also heard it's wet. Whatever. So you get four that you can fill in. The two best for your first group, the two best for your second group. Okay. And again, if you're used to the business model canvas, this is sort of the channels idea. Okay. So questions, comments, concerns, expressions of undying love. I'll take what I can get.
Tell us more of this place outside.
Yeah. It is a legendary place. It is ruled over by a vast space called sky.
Questions?
I'm answering everyone's question as I go along, apparently.
I actually have a question.
Oh, great.
Great.
Jay, do you remember showing the, giving us the tour for the, in the business tools in Seattle Public Library website, where we could research the demographics and see the, also the best channels, how to reach a specific group of people. Do you think that will be a great tool for this as well? And in terms of where?
Absolutely.
Yes. Jay, go ahead, take it away.
Well, what I think you've touched on here is that those are the tool, those are the information. This is how to use them. Like, this is how to use, this is how you can take what I showed you in demographics now and, you know, action it, you know, like, so the two definitely go together very well. So thank you for bringing that up.
Yeah, this is awesome. Like, this is so easy to connect the dots instantly. This is really, really awesome.
And you can see I'm excited about this because I know how that like how that information that we were talking about ties into this exactly, and how you can take, like, to find data about, you know, how many, like we were seeing in that slide where the cascade, well, that's where that would come, you know, is demographics now is our best tool for that.
And for those that have not, that are, you know, on the call and have not heard of it, the library can help you. You can rent a librarian. You don't call it that. You can make an appointment with a librarian and get some help. But essentially, the library has tons of resources for you to find some of this information. Another related to this, I had a client who wanted to make dentures. That was the business, and I was like, okay, cool. You know, I haven't had a denture maker before, but let's do this. And I was reading through his business plan, and it said he was going to take out an ad in the Stranger. Now, if you're not from around Seattle and hearing this or watching the video later or whatever, the Stranger is a weekly newspaper here that's kind of you know, funky, edgy, counterculture kind of a paper. And I was like, oh, the Stranger, huh? So then I'm thinking, well, who is he trying to reach? And I was like, oh, maybe like you know, like skateboarders who've knocked out a tooth, or, you know, like maybe something like that. And so I was like, well, so who's your audience? And he's like, oh, well, you know, the elderly. And I was like, okay, maybe I don't know the audience of the Stranger as well as I think I do. I was like, well, how many older people read the Stranger regularly? Because, you know, like, I don't know for sure. I just, you know, like, gut feeling is not quite right, you know, often. And so it's like, oh, so what percentage of elderly people read The Stranger? And it just, like, his, I could see it dawning on him that he hadn't quite connected those two. And he's like, oh, you mean I should market somewhere else? I'm like, well, if you're trying to reach elderly people, you should, you know, put an ad where elderly people will see it. You know, like that's kind of how this works. And so doing research into, you know, like, we never actually looked up how many elderly people read The Stranger. Maybe that would have been a good idea. I don't know. But the point is that it's important to verify your impressions and to find out as much real information as you can. And like I said, the library's great for this. Like, yeah. Get yourself a library card, head on over.
Book time with us.
Yes, book time with a librarian. Do you want to say something about that at the end?
Yeah, I'll say something at the end, and I'll put the links in the chat and to, like, where you find the tools, where you can set up time, all that.
Great. Great. Okay, so let us move on for some more. Whoops, again, the wrong mouse. All right, so you've got your goal and you've got your people and where to find them. Cool. Now it comes down to, you know, like you'll have to do marketing at some point. So just knowing what you would like to have happen isn't enough. I have over my desk a quote from former British Prime Minister Benjamin Disraeli that says, action may not always bring happiness, but there is no happiness without action. And next to it, I have a similarly themed, action-themed quote, which is actually from Chinese, that is, talk does not cook rice. Right? So we need to move this sort of conceptual stuff, right? We've narrowed down our options to, we're trying to get these people in these places to help us with our goal. But now we need to shift it over sort of into the real world. And we do that with the what, the green box. And this is specifically approached by asking, if you were to be in one of those places and run into some of those people, what kind of interaction would you hope to have happen? What do you want to happen in that place with those people? Okay, so we've got about six things again here that it can look really different depending on what you're trying to do, but it might be a networking thing. It might be, just like exchanging business cards, being helpful to someone so that they think more highly of you, or, you know, like whatever the exchange is to make that connection with other people. Maybe it's engagement. Maybe you just want them to do a thing. You want to talk to them about the conference you went to. Maybe you want to, ask them their opinion about whatever. It could be listening, right? It could be, oh, tell me about, oh, really? How are you solving that problem? How are you thinking about that problem? Is it really like, what is your most important factor to solving what you're doing? Right? Might be that learning goal. It might be publishing, and maybe this should have air quotes around it, publishing, but publishing in the sense of, like handing out a brochure, or I just want to give my elevator pitch, or, I don't want to be listening to you. I want you to be listening to me. Could be curation. So museum curators, you never see the whole collection. Right, you see like a tiny fraction of what a museum's collection has. And so the curator chooses stuff that make a good exhibit. Curation in this sense is when, for example, how I do curation is if I go to some sort of event or am talking with people and someone says something and I think of a book that I have read that I think would be helpful for them, I will recommend that book or I will recommend that resource. So that kind of, oh, I think this particular thing would be good for you. That's curation. That's saying I have synthesized a bunch of things and narrowed it down and made it easy for you. So you don't have to do that work. You don't have to sort through all of that. Okay. So that's curation, another thing that could happen. Or it could just be promotion. Hey, buy from me. Hey, here's my coupon. Here, whatever. Okay. Now, there might be other things, again. But you want to think of what should happen. What event? The what is like an event, an experience. What thing should happen? And again, business model canvas is kind of the customer relationships box-ish. This is not as good a connection as the previous two, but it'll do. Okay, so this is moving you into action. I have a goal. I have two groups of people that can help me reach that goal. I have places to find those people in high concentrations. And now when I run into them, I know what I want to have happen in that moment. All right. So, last-ish, the last shape is the blue triangle. Now here you only get one. Only get one. But the triangle is the habit or the repeat action that you will do. It is concrete. It is specific enough that it makes sense, like on a to-do list or a repeating appointment. And this is your true action. And it is answering the question, how do I make the green box happen? Okay, so if your green box is, I want to have a networking conversation with one of these groups. Well, your blue triangle might be, going to a networking event, or it might be setting up an interview, or it might be cold calling 10 people, or it might, whatever it is, it's the action that makes the green square happen. Okay. And again, you want it to be the best one. You want it to be the thing that is most likely to make that green square happen. Now it says here, act, experiment, gather data, and evaluate. Actually, I'll go into a little bit more about that in a second. But you may not know for certain what the best thing is, but you should pick what you think is the best thing and keep track, right? This is you don't know for sure, but since this is where sort of your behaviors, your effort will go into, this is kind of the place where you should be watching, because that's where you'll interact the most. This is the most concrete, obvious place. Okay. So before I go into sort of putting all of the pieces together as a system, are there any questions?
I do.
Excellent.
I am not entirely sure if I get this one, because
okay,
the how is really, it also is very directly related with where, with what. So I think I'm a bit confused on this one.
Okay, so do you happen to have an example green square that might be useful for you.
Green,
if you don't, that's fine. But
green square was what, right?
Was what? Yeah. What kind of interaction would you want to have with that group in that place?
I would, in my case, I would go for promotion.
Okay, so you want to have a conversation with this group to just kind of like give them a sales pitch or something like that.
Right, right.
You know, like on a high level. Okay, so well, how do you make sure that you get to do that? Depending on your other choices, it might be like perhaps you perhaps you're looking to one of your groups is say a coffee shop, right? Coffee shops as a group. I'm drinking tea, so maybe it's a tea shop. I don't know. But if you're trying to enroll coffee shops, maybe your how is go to a coffee shop and ask who the manager is, or the, you know, person that does the buying, or the, you know, whoever you want to make that presentation to. It might be using tools from the library to identify, neighborhoods that you could send flyers to, and then send flyers to those people. It might be, you know, like whatever is the specific action that gets you in front of the people you want to promote to.
Okay, so
does that help? Go ahead.
I want to reach, let's say the same example as you did, software engineers, for example.
Okay, sure.
And then let's say software engineers mostly read email marketing.
Okay.
So, and my goal is to promote.
Okay.
And so my how would be sending out email marketing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, send out, you know, like if you set up a email newsletter, your how could be, you know, send out a weekly, daily, monthly, whatever the right frequency is, send out a new issue, right? Or send out a, you know, don't do this, you know, send out my spam blast. or whatever it is, right? But it's the action that is doing the actual marketing.
Mm-hmm. Got it. So it's like math. It's formula.
Yeah. This is the most sort of formulaic piece of it. All the other stuff gets you sort of focused on the right thing. If we go back to the idea of the bonsai tree, right? This is the actual snipping of the branch that you don't want to have be there, right? It is the observable action that makes the eventual vision possible. Everything beyond this has at least some level of abstraction and theoreticalness, if that's a word.
Gotcha. It makes perfect sense. Thank great. You.
Yep. Anyone else? What's our time? Okay, great. Only have a couple more slides, so I will just hit them real quickly. So iteration, if you are not familiar with this word, is basically repeating a process. You do something once, maybe you adjust, you do it again, etc. So like, you know, aiming You know, you okay, closer and closer and closer and closer and closer until you're. The idea of iteration is important to both developing the strategy and doing the marketing. So you may have sort of ideas for all of your boxes, and that's the first iteration. Second iteration, maybe you do some research and you refine it a little bit. You're like, okay, but now this connection doesn't seem so great. And so you do another iteration and you keep going through until you have a strategy that's like, yeah, this feels tight. This feels like if I do these things, I'm pretty sure this is going to be successful. Okay, so that's the big iteration cycle. Then the little iteration cycle is those actions. Do you send out the email every month? Do you go to the networking meeting every month? Do you do your cold calling or whatever you do? Are you doing that? And is that actually getting you the results that you want? And so you want to be doing that. You want to be doing those cycles over and over and over and over again, and watching the results. And then at some point, if you're not getting the results you want, it's time to experiment a little bit and maybe tweak some things. I would tweak lower. If you think your upper ones are more solid, like if you're really sure that you've got the right people, maybe it's just you haven't chosen the right tactic, right? We talked earlier about strategy versus tactics. The blue squares, I mean, the blue triangles and the green squares are tactical. They are things that you choose to do. Strategy is the overall pattern. It is the pathway. So iterate, do it for a while, enough that you can see, is this really working? Realize that sometimes there's a delay before what you do shows progress, right? Do it long enough that delay, you are past where that delay might be before you change things. Because otherwise you'll start getting distracted and being like, well, maybe I could do this. Well, maybe I could do this. Well, maybe I could do this. And now suddenly you're not being strategic anymore. You're just like trying stuff. Oh, look, it's Benjamin Disraeli himself. once you've got your plan, do it. Because there is no happiness without action. Okay, so if you want to sort of implement this and maybe go on to next week's class, which is about website statistics and how do you get information from, or like how people are using your website, work a little bit on your first iteration. Now, you might do it in a number of different ways, but one that some people have found useful is to do a sentence. So like each week I will triangle in order to trigger square when I encounter a circle at a plus so that they can help me achieve star. Right, you can kind of plug in representative words from each of those shapes to describe what you're doing. You may have, you know, 8 sentences, because we'll see the diagram here in a second. There are a total of 8 triangles, so maybe you have 8 sentences, one for each thing, but or maybe you write it up as a narrative, you know, like, here's my strategy. I am going to do this whole list of things because My target market is this, and they concentrate in these places or whatever, you know, however you want to do it, whatever is most helpful for you. Because what makes this strategic is you have said no to all of the things that are not those two groups, those four places, those 8, 4, 17, I don't know however many squares. let's go on to the, oh yeah, what's next? Whoop, there's the chart. Right, you have narrowed down all of your options to 8 specific actions that you've determined are the most likely, the best options for you to do in order to reach your goal. And so if you just focus on those 8 things, that is not overwhelming. I mean, it might be, but it's less overwhelming than all of the actions that you could be doing, right? If you came up with all of the things that you might do to market, that's definitely overwhelming. A list of 8 is something that's, you know, controllable and definable and an even number and 2 cubed and, you know, like whatever. But it's like, you can fit that in a box. And so that's what this process is about, is narrowing down to the very best things and then carrying it out. Okay. So I'm going to stop there. If people have questions, go ahead and put them in the chat or whatever. And Jay can kind of tell a little bit more about library things, but I will bow out and stop sharing if I can find where that control is. And there it is. So take it away, Jay.
All right. Thank you, Michael. So I put the link to the chat where, or the link in the chat where you can both find the tools for that we've been talking about. Demographics now is usually the right, you know, the first one, but not always. Like that one, you know, when we're talking about households, that can, you know, be helpful. But if you some of the examples we were talking about here were like business owners, you know, we were trying to reach, you know, those we might use a different tool. Demographics now is a nice run to, but that's why you can book an appointment with me or my colleagues. So we have 7 librarians at the Seattle Public Library who have training in business research. And those are the folks on the other end of that booking tool that you'll find there. Book one of the ones that says business and nonprofit or business information appointment, business and nonprofit information appointment or business information appointment. Either one will work if you're a for-profit. If you're a nonprofit, book one of the ones that says nonprofit in there, because we might have some other tools we can share with you. And you might need the same kinds of marketing tools also. That's how you can, the other part that I did put in there also was if you're not seeing a time that works for you, and I acknowledge that, like, the next appointment is probably towards the end of the month. and that's because they've been just very popular. Do write to us at l2b@spl.org. And we will see what we can do. We try to help if we can. We'll try to accommodate your schedule if you're not finding a time in there. Those appointments, we really start with by listening to, you know, what you're working on, talk more about that so that we can then identify some specific resources that we hope will be helpful. So I think that's what I wanted to share. I guess, why don't we wrap up the recording and then open it up for any questions that people might have been shy about asking while we were recording. So if you are listening to this after the fact, thank you for listening. We hope you enjoyed this. We hope you'll book time with a librarian who will help you with your market research and come to these next classes. There's a reason we put this one second because it kind of ties the thread together with some of the other stuff that we talk about throughout the rest of the classes here. And we will be recording all of them as well too. So,
well, and it's also useful to know roughly what your strategy is before you get into some of the specifics of, you know, website and technology and whatever. Yeah,
social media choice, all those
social media, yeah. Right?
Yeah, strategy ties it together and like helps you to know that. Okay. Well, thanks everyone. If you're here live now, stay online if you like and ask questions. Thanks everyone.
Thank you. It.